the cumulative effect that the change agents who have been operating, I would tell you they've already been well established in the Seven Mountain Mandate that so many NAR, Dominionist, New Apostolic Reformation, Turncoat, New Age, Luciferians, light workers, new thought leaders, devils, wolves, ravenous wolves, Jesus told us, dressed up like sweet, innocent little lambs. They have come to kind of the pinnacle of their work of deception. And they have been so proficient in warping the hearts and minds of people generation after generation. And we'll just say from Laurel Canyon staging of the Woodstock type of social bite back against traditional Christian values and holding the fabric of society together, that the salt content of the gospel and the people and the light and so on and so forth, as far as putting together some type of foundation for life and reality that people operated by. Not that that only started in the 60s. I mean, you could go back and back and back. There was things happening before that. That is an interesting study. I don't have time to get into all that, nor do I want to sidetrack off to that. But you can really see just this massive staged from, yes, the CIA, yes, the change agents, yes, the people in positions of power over you, yes, the thought shapers, the doctrine shapers. Everything is a doctrine, whether it's biblical doctrine, against biblical doctrine, all of the different worldviews, all of the antichrist-oriented type of agenda has come through the media. I think the media, the television cameras and all of that, and the internet now, all of your devices and such, literally is the absolute crowning jewel of Satan's most effective tool used to program an apostasy. And it's been going on a long time, staged, organized evil. Part of their game that they play is it's very disconnected and disjointed in terms of the way it's presented. And they're just gaslighting you, right? I mean, you go to channels that exist out there and they're like, okay, you have all these, and I hate this word, but I'm going to use it so you know what I'm talking about. Celebrities, for example, as I'm setting you up for the story, oh, it's bad. And they all are doing these various symbolic hand signs of a symbolic non-linguistic language that communicates precisely who these people serve as their programming people, the one-eye symbol, the 666, that they are the unredeemed seeking godhood. And a lot could be said about that sign and how they go about using Crowleyan sex magic and abusing little boys. And you start examining the 666 and start to kind of figure out how that is being communicated via symbol form and how these absolutely vile, disgusting pigs that walk the earth that hurt children. You know, Satan will give you stuff if you hurt someone for it. That is his goal. And you just see this massive organized campaign through the media, through the church, through the government, through Edward Bernays style propaganda, behavioral changing input through popular media, through pop culture, the teaching, the seeding of contextual elements of evil that procure sin and shape attitudes that are put inside of you to change your behavior, to manipulate you, are done through what is termed entertainment. But beloved, please, I beg you, do not be so naive. Your cartoons, your Disney, oh, don't get me started on Disney. It is all designed to change the way you think. It is all a game of influence. You wouldn't have multi-million dollar and billion dollar, maybe a trillion dollar when you consider all of it, ad producing, advertisements, PR propaganda, that whole arm of an industry to change the way people think about products, to sell services, and kind of lower under the radar to sell you ideas. And so it's not entertainment, even if it entertains you. It is soil-changing corruption, either to the good, where it would be good things for your soul, which sometimes are used, but very most frequently media, which is a neutral tool in and of itself. But the people, the number of people, the rich, wealthy social engineers are by and large, they make them the largest faction of people that have access to those networks, that create those shows, that hire the writers, that get their ideas for what kinds of things they want to do. And then they start chipping away, deconstructing Christianity, making Jesus look like this or that, stupid or what, you know, whatever, making Christians into a caricature and sort of putting an identity into susceptible minds as to what God is like, what Christians are like, this and that. And then they also have all of these fake, evil Christian supposed pastors, wink, wink. And they are also Luciferians playing the game. They're playing a role. And you know that they're in on it because they oftentimes never talk about rebirth. So these pastors, not only do they withhold the critical information of how to be born again, and that almost never makes it to the table. There's a reason for that. If I was Satan, I would pay you millions of dollars too, as I'm not, but and I would have you promote everything in the world except for rebirth. Yeah, I would put you on a path to destruction with so much entertainment. And I would give you all sorts of religiosity and churchianity. I do love those words. And I would withhold that simplistic gospel from you. And that's exactly what they've done. So, all that to lay a foundation of where we're going today. That my heart is so grieved. Oh, that's the word. Yeah, that's the word. I was trying to figure out what is that weird emotion that you were feeling. And I couldn't quite put words to it because it was a sadness, but it wasn't quite sad. And it was an internal disgust, but it wasn't quite disgust. I couldn't quite put my finger on it, but yes, that word is good. Grieved my heart for humanity and where they are being led to the precipice to jump off the cliff into pure spiritual suicide. Yeah, that's what it is. We'll have to work that in the title, maybe. Don't I always have long titles? anyhow, and spiritual suicide is not a funny thing, but you know, if you don't laugh, you'll cry. But I am completely grieved and sickened that the Pied Pipers from hell in the church, some of the worst human beings on the face of the planet who are like, trust me, I know the Bible, I'll lead you to where you need to go. No, these are change agents. These are bad people. And I'd like to introduce you to one now. You will be horrified by the end of this video, as I am. But, you know, I just want to encourage us and remind us, as I remind myself, that even if you are grieved, as I am, this shows you how accurate, dead on accurate, 100%, no misses, only hits, that God's word is that there would be a staged apostasy where people would defect from the truth. And that is exactly 100% what you see happening. But it's not just happening. That's the thing. It is being created, crafted. There are people, literally, there are multi-million, billion, and trillion-dollar people that get together with the access of information of the behavioral scientists, the people that study also how the brain works. And these people are, is there a word higher than expert level? I don't know. These people are at the top of their game to figure out master level. Thank you, son. Expert on how to manipulate you, on how to get their coded information into you through books, movies, television, cartoons. Cartoons is what we're really going to focus on today. Videos. I mean, just name a modem of media, and that is how they turn a society away from God and deconstructionism. And then they put something in place of it, the reconstructionism of this focus to a goddess. Yeah, it's, you have people that are holding to a form of godliness, right? It's an outside veneer. It's an appearance. It has nothing to do with legit rebirth. The word churchianity, I think, fits so well. It says here, biblical teaching from our good friends at Wikipedia, but it's right. The noun apostasia, that is rebellion, abandonment, state of apostasy, defection. And what are they defecting from? The truth. And it is found only twice in the New Testament, Acts 21:21 and 2 Thessalonians 2:3. So let's, the Thessalonians one I know better than Acts. So let's go see. I actually don't think that is a rapture passage. I know some people teach that. I'm very pre-tribulation, according to the feast, for those who are legitimately born again. I'm very much seeing that those who are playing games with God, God sees that. You're not tricking him. And they are going to be left behind to this correction and receive their just reward. But some people will repent. And I go by the feast. Okay, so 2 Thessalonians 2:3. Let no man deceive you by any means. So you mean there's going to be a huge amount of deception coming? Uh-huh. And it's going to come from your most trusted leaders among you? Uh-huh. And you should totally not listen to them, because your Bible that spans the decades of these people writing to you through the power of the Holy Spirit warned you, deceit, 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 and deception is coming and will be the primary chief sign to know that Christ's coming is imminent. And when I say imminent, I mean biblically what imminent means. That just means soon. It does not mean random. It's according to his feasts. We know this from the Bible. Anyhow, for that day, what day? Oh, Yom Hadin, the day of judgment. Yom Teruah. Go ahead and let him in, honey. The correction, the start of Jacob's time of trouble, Daniel's 70th week, that day when God goes, who got born again following directions and who did not? And then he splits right down the middle between those who are sons of God by rebirth, and those who are slaves that are still in their first birth. They didn't follow directions. They didn't want God. Read Galatians. It's all in there. 3 and 4. Except there come a falling away first. So if I could ask Paul, what did you mean that there would be a falling away first? You would understand that this is organized from the top. you would understand that there are people that know every in and out of how to manipulate us emotionally, spiritually, biochemically. These people have been doing it for a long time. They're really skilled at their art of deception and their masterminding of manipulating people. And this whole idea that we'll do all the thinking for you. We'll make it easy for you. We'll tell you what to believe, what to think, what to do, what to worship, what you're not allowed to worship, right? That whole train of thought. That's here now. That's going to accelerate. So it's staged. It's articulated. Somebody has come up with this, and then they send out their missionaries from hell. Missionaries from hell. How can I work that into the title? To lead you to the antichrist, the counterfeit, the scumbag, as I like to say, because this person is going to kill a whole bunch of humans through the power of Satan, Lucifer, the rebellious angel, the fake God. Everything with these people is fake, 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 fake. And people will forfeit their souls in hell for a lie, a multi-layered, multi-faceted, big giant lie. And God isn't, I think people think that right before they get tossed into hell, God's going to be like, no, I totally like you. Never mind. It's okay. Don't worry about it. I'll forgive you anyhow. No, that's not how it works. Remember, unbelievers didn't want mercy. They didn't want love. They didn't want hope. They didn't want another chance. They just wanted their way. And that's bad enough. But when you actually have apostles who are fake, counterfeit, anti-bride, big giant liars who draw people away for a purpose to bring them to the Antichrist. That is the pinnacle, the height of evil. So this is a very, very high level, organized, choreographed, very substantive obviously manipulative, but Pied Piper organized leading people away from the truth of Jesus Christ to the counterfeit of everything, a counterfeit kingdom, a counterfeit gospel, a counterfeit spirit, many spirits, a counterfeit God who's a big giant loser. Who's not Yahweh. He's just a spoiled little brat that apparently was really beautiful and wanted to be like God. Quite the little liar. Everything that we have, they have a counterfeit. We have signs and miracles and wonders. Sometimes people beat cancer. Sometimes people stop breathing and they get them breathing again. I mean, whatever, blah, blah, blah. All the different miracles that could exist. They have that too, only they're demonic and awful. And when our Holy Spirit takes up residence in someone, guess what he doesn't do? He doesn't manifest shrieking. I can tell you that right now. He doesn't manifest out of control, out of balance, psychotic body movements, freaking out, falling on the floor, acting drunk, acting stupid, acting out of sync with what is normative. Forcing you into body postures that you did not make your body do. Just a whole litany of things. For everything God has, Satan has a counterfeit. God has good preachers. Satan does too. God has good, well, not prophets anymore, but at one point he had prophets. Satan has those too. They're big giant liars. We have a Bible and doctrine. Satan has a doctrine too. And your movies are where you get that doctrine, which is why you can have churches like the church we just left bringing Star Wars into the church, the Force. Because, you know, that's so much of the Bible. Oh, wait, no, that's not. They have a direction they want society to go in, and they want to offer you the counterfeit of all of these things. And you see this coming creation of this anti-bride, this whore of Babylon. And she's going to get it later on. that she's forming, she's growing, and she's getting really blatant with the evil. And she's comprised of men and women. She is a city of darkness that encompasses the earth. She is a community of like-minded, this generation, unbelievers that seeketh after a sign, but no sign shall be given except the sign of Jonah, i.e. the resurrection, death, burial, resurrection. They have a coming Godhead. They have, I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on this because we want to get to the story, but they have a Godhead of, and not a father God, no, a mother, your mother. Who doesn't love mumsy? But it's going to be some kind of a technological super witchcraft from hell type of female Mother Earth, living, moving, breathing, abominable statue of some type of technological form that when it comes, you know, whoever's going to be here for it, you'll be like, oh, that's it. And Jesus called it the abomination of desolation. When it comes, it's going to destroy a lot of life. She, of course, has a son, a fake Messiah, a fake son, a big giant AI-enhanced Jewish imposter who will be called the Beast. He will have all the best traits. I think they've been working on him in a lab for a long time. Long time. Much more could be said about that. And then they have a fake Holy Spirit. Yay! And we'll be getting into and doing a separate video on this. But you ought to know that they have advanced with their creepidocious Elon Musk, at least him being the poster boy of this. I think there's a huge number of scientists working on this, but they have come just so far now to make you a fake Holy Spirit, getting you used to implantables. I don't think this is the mark of the beast. I think it is a step and a breath right before the mark of the beast. There's no commerce attached to this at this moment. That will be a definitive thing. You can't get it unless you say uncle and worship this Mother Earth AI abomination of desolation thing and her creepy AI-enhanced Messiah that all the Jews in unbelief are crying for their Mashiach. And this is the fake Holy Spirit that goes inside your temple, and they will be inside the temple coming in Israel that you have people pushing for. I'm going to be releasing a video. I did it last night, and I hope I wasn't too snarky. You know, you can't quite control your flesh as well when you're, you know, tired at nighttime, but we did a video, and that will be forthcoming. I will proof it and try to take out anything too particularly snarky. But anyhow, they have a fake Holy Spirit that they want to get in your temple, and it is the brain-computer interface. I don't know why they made it plural. That's weird. Separating fact from fiction of Musk's brain implant claims. And this is one of many articles, but they have a creepy machine now. Now you can yoke with and be one with the AI, and nobody stops to ask, what is the AI? Oh, no. Where did it come from? Oh, no. Is it a good idea to trust it and put it in your body? I don't know, but it's cool. Oh, okay, that's good enough. And there'll be people that run to this. And you're like, oh, wait a minute, let me see. Didn't the Bible say something about a big, huge, giant delusion, a lie that was coming? Satan gaining the upper hand of a selfish populace of rebellious. Hey, wait, didn't we hear about that word in apostasy? Rebellious? Yes, we did. Oh, we never checked out that Acts 21:21. I want to see that. A global group of people that align together as, quote, the body of Christ. Who is that? Oh, remember, she's all the world religions in one big messy ball of insanity, including a spot for NAR. Including a spot for a universalist like Lauren Daigle and for King and Country, who I no longer have respect for. They did soundtrack for The Shack. So much more could be said on that. But they are making for you, for that group of people who are growing, they are making you a handy dandy little Neuralink. You want to become enhanced with the internet? You want to become the internet? Do you? Anything you want to know? Now you don't have to punch in those pesky little keys to look up something. Now you are the internet. Doesn't that sound good? Don't you want to worship things that aren't God to become like God? Doesn't that sound like a great idea? No. But that's where they're going. Hey, we're going to take your neurons and your brain, and we're going to connect them up to this machine thingy, and we're going to put this little chip and combine the iron with the clay. Oh, wait a minute. You mean like Daniel 2? You mean like what Daniel said was going to be the end form of this world before Christ comes back? Slams into that Daniel statue, and that rock fills the whole earth, and that's Christ's coming kingdom that they're trying to fake right now. Nar. Yeah, that's exactly what I'm saying. Now, I don't know how they're going to do all this. I have no idea. But they have got some really smart people working on this, and they are making strides. Yes, they are. Yay, puppy, you get to become a fake god. Won't that be precious? This person says, our mind's eye fills with everything from the Borg and the neural interfaces of Star Trek to the neural recording devices with parent control blocking features from Black Mirror, and of course, the enslavement of the human race by machines in the Matrix. And then the nonstop ads, even while you sleep. Well, my goodness. Okay, so, wow. This was an article back in summer of 2019. Well, I mean, that would go along really well with the Vatican's Humanity 2.0. I have a whole bunch of videos on that. I'll have to put those links in there for you. And people can also use the search feature. But yeah, they want to get a fake Holy Spirit into you for life extension. And then I guess ultimately somehow, I don't know if they'll be able to go this far, but they want to put like your consciousness, your soul or whatever, into a digitized form or something and stick it in some type of computer so you can live forever. Oh, but you know, God's going to start doing things like, oh, I don't know, having the sun explode fire onto the earth. They didn't see that one coming. That's one of the 21 judgments. That's the good fun of the correction that's coming. Yeah, that's coming. Can't imagine why humanity and a global rebellion against God wanting to fight Yahweh and become like him. That sounds familiar. Where do I know that story from? Oh, that's right. Genesis 3. You're going back around to Genesis 3. So you have a fake godhood, fake mama, who's not the father, right? Fake son from hell. And then you have a fake Holy Spirit to go in your temple and to cause you to become a new creation, the Antichrist, humanity 2.0, which is a firm, hard rejection of salvation in Jesus. And Jesus goes, I accept your rejection. And then people go pay for their own sins in hell. So that fun is coming. So what does this have to do with Disney? Disney's evil. They're just evil. Well, I am over here at Reformation Charlotte, who I am so thankful for. So, oh, you know what? We never went to go look at that scripture really quick. Here, quick tease. Let's go look at Acts 21:21. Did that get included in here? No, fine. We'll go find it. And make changes and alterations they ought not to. Let me get that for you. Okay, so Acts 20 is where it's at. And I like that he starts off in verse 27. Look at what he says. He's basically making a speech that I've done everything I was supposed to do to help you. And then they chopped his head off, which I'm sure felt really good. Not. But that's how it works. The blood of the martyrs, the witnesses, have seeded the gospel forward to us all these thousands of years later by way of their sacrifice. Obviously not as important as Jesus' sacrifice, but nonetheless, proved apostles. They loved us. They cared for us. They gave everything. And then they took their heads, or they got whatever. He was beheaded. It says here in verse 27, "For I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God." So wait, you tell all the counsel of God, not just parts and bits and pieces? Paul, you don't know how it works in modern day Christianity. They just amputate a verse out of context, pepper it in as a token verse, and then give a whole sermon based on their thoughts. And you're giving the whole counsel of God? "Take ye therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Spirit hath made you overseers to feed the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood." So the God-man, Jesus. "For I know this, that after my departing," look at this, "shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. And also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. Therefore watch, be aware, be awake, get this, perceive, and remember that by the space of 3 years I ceased not to warn everyone night and day with tears. And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified." And he goes on to talk about some other things. Oh, and look at how they received him. Oh, in verse 37, after he says all this, he says, "And they all wept sore, and they fell on Paul's neck," which is like a hug, "and kissed him." Yay. Yay for Paul. Okay, so the Gospel Coalition, you know, the fine folks at the Gospel Coalition. I just did a very lengthy video on Albert Mohler and Russell Moore and Sam Alberry, who are perverting and twisting scripture to basically make an inroads for the Rainbow Mafia into the church. So that's their shtick and their end of it. But that's not all. Not when you come to the apostasy train here. So the Gospel Coalition of Heresy promotes Mother Goddess. You want that in your good Christian teaching for your kids. You want to promote the goddess. Oh, no, wait, you don't. That's Antichrist. That's the counterfeit. That's the opposite of the Father. That is evil, wicked, that will take people to hell. That is a counterfeit God. Why, then, you might ask, would a Christian organization be promoting this? For the whole reason. For the whole reason I explained in the setup of this video, that this is an organized withdrawal from the truth, an abandoning. And they want you to be a part of it. They're going to hell in their deceivableness of unrighteousness, as the Bible puts it.
We'll all go to hell.
And they all want you to join them. Now, if you're truly born again, you can't. You can't be unborn again. But this is a threat that is put out to the other religious fakes that don't have the Holy Spirit. That's the concern. So anyhow, the Gospel Coalition promotes Mother Goddess and says that Frozen 2 theme song is an example of a prayer to the unknown God. Uh-huh. Pastor approved. Yep, yep. And it's posted by Jeff Maples. Can we get a picture of Jeff at all? Do you put your little face out there, Jeff? All right, fine, whatever. Oh, good. Filthy rap songs at church. That's what you want. That's, if you were the devil, that's what you'd want. Sure, yeah. Okay. Modern emergent Christianity can find a gospel theme in practically any pagan cultural piece of art that exists, no matter how godless and antichrist it is. From Harry Potter to Star Wars. I would also interrupt that and
don't
say,
Kanye West.
And come on, and where else can you find the gospel? Because the Bible's boring, don't you know?
I just woke up. Oh, Stranger Things.
You get the bingo. Yes. Now, I'm not saying the Bible is boring, but Michael Heiser is, and he says you can find the gospel in a prepubescent 11-year-old.
No, he says you can find the gospel in Stranger Things, and you can find a great modern version of Jesus and the Holy Spirit in a prepubescent 11-year-old L or 11.
Who has been MK Ultra'd, and they are using to try to procure psychic abilities in her in the forbidden spiritual
and
realm.
Obviously been sexually abused.
Yeah. So that's Michael Heiser. So anyhow, from Harry Potter to Star Wars to Stranger Things, Kanye West performances, on and on and on it goes. This.
Don't forget the Christian tarot cards.
I haven't even gone
like,
there yet.
Where are you in Australia?
Your destiny card reading. No, don't. Throw a Bible at him and run.
No, kick him in the face and heal him.
Yeah, Todd Bentley. We had fun yesterday. It was hard. Yesterday was a hard day of research. Really hard. I slept good, though. Anyhow, these endless charades in these elite circles continue to try and justify their infatuation with Hollywood propaganda by drawing some kind of piecemeal biblical conclusion from the work. The fact is, surprisingly, I know, it's a shocker, it's not there. What? The Gospel Coalition, run by the devil, recently penned an article titled Into the Unknown and the Unknown God. Yeah. Where the author, Pastor Joey Toma, I'm not going to be able to pronounce that, compares the Frozen 2 theme song Into the Unknown. Is that the song that Aurora does? Because we did a video on Aurora being the wind. Aurora with apple tree covered in blood, demonically possessed as Mother Earth's children. She's a big giant like Greta Thunberg, but from hell. Not that Greta's innocent either, as this staged insanity. Isn't she the one that does that song? So we will check into that and see if that is the part that Aurora from the Netherlands peppered into this, because she's very like tribal, ancient, Mother Earth, young people, let's kill everything that doesn't agree with us. She's a freaky girl. She's a trip. Anyhow, so this song, to the pagan prayers to the unknown God in Athens in Acts 17, I'm telling you, these people are expert level deception artists. They are so good at lying through their teeth to you and coming up with this cacophony of insanity.
Are you talking about Michael Brown?
No. Oh, he's the worst. No. Do not like Michael Brown's lying straight to you. It says, yeah, in his effort to draw this conclusion from Disney's latest hit, he seemingly promotes some kind of mother goddess earth worship writing. Well, yes, because this is the agenda. This is not just him getting up one day and going, you know what? The world needs more mother earth worship. That's, yeah. No, there's a whole panel of entities that have been placed into all areas of media and influence, the church being one of them. Seven Mountain Mandate, Dominionism. We're going to make the world a better place and take it back for Jesus. And never mind the fact you're going to get the Antichrist, the counterfeit Jesus, and they're the counterfeit bride. So there's a lot of people that are going according to a script. And you're their target. Your children are their target. They don't really care about you. You know, you're old and they don't care about you. You're just...
We got the minds. We got the you.
Mm-hmm. Kanye said it in his crappy songs. He's a Christian. No, he's not.
No, we got the minds. We got the youth.
Yep. They do have the youth. the youth, that's a whole nother track of thought. The children don't even know what's going on.
Don't believe me. Look up the lyrics to Selah, S-E-L-A-H, from Kanye West.
Yeah, they've got the tools and they've got the youth. Look up Selah. Kanye West Selah. He's one of them.
They don't just have the youth. They got the youth minds. And they already know it.
Oh, yeah. They're completely demonic, these people. So he says artists are enchanters, they're prophets and even intercessors, expressing unspoken longings that are hard to articulate. To love the world around us, we must learn to listen to her art. Her art, who? I would say that they are telling you that there is this new one world church coming. And we've talked about this on a lot of videos. Babylon, the big giant whore. They're wanting to be called the body of Christ, but they're not in Christ. Deifying and personifying the world, referencing creation as her. Okay, an extension of Mother Earth, yeah. He expresses in some kind of collective sense that the world, through its prophets, intercessors, and antennas, have some kind of special revelation to give us through art. Of course, this is unbiblical nonsense rooted in the idolatry of self. Yeah. Nowhere do the scriptures speak of art or artists having some kind of power to communicate any special revelation to us or give us the ability to love it. Well, you know, look up Marina Abramovich. She and Crowley were expert level at teaching you how to do evil through art. A lot of evil can be done through art. Further, as he tries to compare the Frozen 2 song to a call from God, the protagonist of Into the Unknown is haunted by an unknown voice calling her into an unknown space. Oh yeah, that's Aurora doing the soundtrack for it, the wind. The first verse makes clear the voice is from a you who seems to be pursuing the protagonist. As the song builds, we discover that you has a voice but isn't seen, and it's a voice that wields a certain kind of growing power. You might consider this you a thou of sorts, a kind of unknown, wait for it, divine being or force.
It is what's bewitched.
Okay, so I already did a video on this, but just to, in case you didn't know or for new people, this is Aurora. She has this whole Mother Earth tribal, we're gonna come and wipe you out sort of a motif from her apple tree song video.
Like a lovely girl.
Oh yeah, I'm not convinced that's a girl. I mean, maybe, but I wouldn't be surprised if she had male organs. I mean, I'm just saying.
It's a girl's name. It's gotta be a girl. Are you assuming gender?
They have changed her look quite a lot and made her very unique, or him, whatever. And here, she, he, what have you. I think this is a boy for the Kabbalah thing. In Kabbalah, they bring everything together in union. God and man, he and she, human and animal. Kind of like that Baphomet thing. And here, she's holding her hair in such a way that it's actually forming a triangle, if you can see that. And so she has her, what have you. That's a girl? Really? Really? I don't know. But anyhow, she does the sound of this spiritual wind thing. See, Aurora explains how she became the voice of the mountains for Frozen 2 and the Unknown. Unless there's another Mother Earth-esque. I haven't seen this movie.
And won't see it,
yeah. It says here, welcome to the Emerging Artist Spotlight, the Billboard series where we highlight a musician who has recently made his or her debut on the emerging artist chart, because we want to propagandize you. Whether they are new to the industry or been around for a while, blah, blah, blah. She debuted number 8 on the chart for her song Into the Unknown with, is it Idina Menzel, who did the popular song, whatever it was called, I don't care. So then they do the ah, ah, oh, oh. That's part of Aurora's contribution, excuse me, to the juggernaut that is Frozen 2. And it is an important one. The Norwegian artist, why is it important? Is responsible for the ethereal siren call that appears.
What's important is that you get repentant to God.
Yes, that's true. But I was highlighting, thank you, Jane. I was highlighting why are they pulling this out and digesting it for you and telling you, pay attention. Why is it important to them? Appears throughout the film beckoning Queen Elsa to return to her home. Aurora's credit on Into the Unknown alongside Menzel and her simultaneous initiation into the massive family of Disney, oh boy, has quickly opened doors for the singer. Oh yeah, if you're gonna serve Satan, he is gonna fill your piggy bank up. Overflowing. Has certainly opened doors for the singer. Sorry, I said that. While she's previously appeared on the Billboard before for her number 55 on the Hot 100 week of December 7th, and likewise propelled Aurora onto the Emerging Artists chart. How appropriate, because we have emerging Christians. She's not a Christian. She really is the perfect blend of doing what you want. She has video where she explains that she has no imposition or imposing boundaries that she puts on herself. She just does what she wants. And you have the male pretending to be a female, Billie Eilish, that's pushing her. She pushes him. And big nightmare. It makes me very happy, Aurora. That's how she talks, or he. And I'm not making fun of this person. That's just literally how they talk. Tells Billboard of her achievement by email, adding that she always loves to see when a song that carries a strong message reaches the Hot 100. So she is a major, popular, extremely well-defended change agent in her circle of influence among teenagers and what have you. And hailing from Bergen, Norway. Norway's in the Netherlands, right? The singer explains that agreeing to be part of Frozen 2 is a no-brainer. It made me feel very excited. Frozen carries such a magical, powerful story, so I knew it would feel right. She goes by her feelings. It feels right. Must be right. Aurora calls her vocals in an old church in England, calling it a lovely experience. The room was beautiful, round, and it carried my voice to infinity and beyond without any extra reverb, she says, explaining how the stunning setting influenced what would eventually become the voice of the mountains. So I don't think there's any other voice. This is sort of this internal desire, I guess, that they're using. And I'll just show you a tiny little bit here. That's Aurora. Well, they can do that. They remove certain parts of your body. They can achieve that. They're called castrados.
There's a thousand reasons I love just here within these walls. Here to distract me, so I make them. Me that loves to go.
It lures her outside. That's
going to leave me alone.
Yeah. And then did you see the little diamond crackle?
Into the unknown.
But like in that Matrix movie, remember when he stops the bullets in midair, Neo? Because they're all trying to shoot him down and murder him. And that was a weird movie anyhow. That was there three of them, I think? She's doing that with the diamond crystals. There's a whole thing I'm not going to get into right now. But if you know your sacred geometry for research purposes and you understand how the Masons think, you understand how the, you know, the Leonard Sweets of the New Age with quantum spirituality, Kabbalah, you know, everything is God. So you're God, is what they tell you. They are taking these visuals and applying it, seeding it into your schnoggy and your children and teaching them that God is all and God is in everything and God is everything. Just use your fingers. So both Frozen movies largely drew from the Nordic culture as inspiration, which makes Aurora's involvement all the more fitting. Could that have been the plan from the beginning? I don't know. The nature scenes are very well contributing to the landscape and scenes like the one where Elsa and Co travel. I don't know what that means. To the enchanted forest. Oh, goody. More witchcraft. Are appropriately dramatic, beautiful, and dangerous. In that, singing a movie so close to home felt natural, Aurora says. I think it's wonderful how demonic Disney lets different cultures inspire them. It's very important. Yeah, if your goal is to pull all of the nations, all of the religions, all of the cultures, all of the diversity in the unity together, and then just throw a bow on that sucker and call it the body of Christ. You have the one world religion. You have the one world church. You have that big giant Babylonian whore. You dig? And they're seeding it lightly into your children's entertainment. I have a lot of different types of songs. She says, as I struggle to only stay within one genre, if you like Nordic vibe, I would say songs like, and then she gives some examples, which I don't care. If you like to headbang to an anthem for Mother Earth, then Seed is the one. If you're afraid of crying, listen to, and she gives all these different songs. I assume these are her songs and she is promoting herself. Yes. Murder song. You know, nothing is more beautiful, kind, and loving than introducing your 12-year-old to Aurora and her murder song. And I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but go to Apple Tree. Let's go there. Where I want the lyrics. I want the video. Show me the video. She's covered in blood, kind of in like a quartet or triad or whatever it was, of a weird Rainbow Mafia, Mother Earth, Children of the Corn, psychopath, gang of zombie, demonically possessed dancers. They're going to dance their way to the devil. That's how it starts out, that tribal beat, right? And you're like, okay. And it gets weird quick. Why do you say that? I actually love her bangs there. Well, she's drawing blood. It's going to get weird. There's this very strange interaction. They've got their little tribal war stripes. Her and Greta are, they're drawing the youth into this sort of us against them mentality. Not only, you know, our young youthful age against what they perceive to be the old people or older people, but even this, you know, more paganistic earth worship oriented type of belief system, the diversity, the acceptance of the rainbow mafia, basically that you're a god and you can do whatever you jolly well feel like, versus, well, that's what they're nurturing, versus the evil, old, nasty, mean, bad, you know, whatever bad thing they can put on it of Christianity. And there's a war coming. And you really see that message. There you go. With NAR and their Joel's Army thing, right? So they're wrapping everything together in this, you know, tone of war as the body of Christ, the counterfeit air, the counterfeit body, the counterfeit city. A city is a community. God means it in the sense of a global community, a city of darkness, a city of rebellion, not just one city, all the nations together, not just one religion, all the religions together, but to do it in the name of Jesus. But it's not for the real Jesus. People have got to start getting this. It's really important. So these people, weird dance, man, weird, demonic, possessed, tribal. These people get possessed so they can do this stuff. And then Satan rewards them. It just gets weird. So Disney just picked her up. They've advanced her career. Yes. Yes, homegirl has a streak of blood going down her face. She doesn't look a day over 15. And it's there where the Hindis put their third eye mark with that red. I think it's called a bindi, if I'm not mistaken.
The red sticker.
No, it's not. It's a substance, and I believe it's called a bindi. But yeah, it's because they believe. I mean, they worship everything, cows, and all kinds of weird stuff.
Let's go.
And see, this song is it's the apple tree. The apple is representative of going and getting your fake godhood, your gnosis. And they're saying they're willing to draw blood to get it. And this is just so weird. Okay, when she touched her belly, did you see that? I don't want you seeing that. do you see how they've... Anyhow, so much could be said about this, and we've talked about it before, but I mean, can you see the crotchal shots where they have that fake stuff? There's a message behind this of getting everything together into the one stock sample, so to speak, of the boy girl, the divine androgyne, the remove all the distinctives that make you a boy or make you a girl, and just you'll all synthesize into one. You'll make for a perfect slave to the New World Order. No identity. You become a number. Right? And that is an interesting thought. And I do want to get back to the article. But that is an interesting thought that you have to take some kind of a mark that involves a number. I just really wonder if everything starts off with the declaration of your independence from God with like a... This is just my speculation. But it would make sense. 666 and then a dash of some sort that is a IP, a personal like IP number for your body, right? Because they're going to try to make you basically yoke with the internet, yoke with the AI, yoke with the technology. And so you're going to be a walking, what do you want to call it? A port? I don't know what to call it. You're gonna have your own IP address of some sort. I think you would have to. We have them on our computers. Our computers stay in our homes. They want to get this brain machine to put this thing in you. There's a step before the mark of the beast to get people comfortable with implantables, show it off, whet the appetite of people, change you from human to post-human. Change your religious preference away from the one true God into this other fake heir, fake bride, fake body of Christ, blah, blah, blah. And in doing so, maybe there'll be a dash and like your own personal IP number that represents you. I don't know for certain, but you can really see if it got to the point where they took away your name and you got a number. I mean, didn't they do that stuff in Hitler's Germany? Didn't you get reduced down from a special creation of God that had a name and an identity, and you were a mom or a dad or a son or a daughter or a grandma or whatever, and they just took your name and your identity away, dehumanized you, and you became a number? I could see that happening again. Not sure if that's how it will all function and work, but I could see them really stripping all the distinctives away from you, including your gender, your everything, and you just get to become a slave to the machine and the machine world. Anyhow, much more could be said about that, but there's definitely a strong theme of Mother Earth, and it is all the worse when you get... Did you see her in the butterfly? They made her a butterfly. That's not MK Ultra at all. Yes. That is right. You cannot become a god. Mm-hmm. No more than you can become a tomato.
My mom's old saying, you can choke on a hot dog and die.
Yep. Choke on a hot dog and you're dead. That's it. You might consider this you a vow of sorts, he talks about. He's saying here that further, this pastor tries to compare the Frozen 2 theme song to a call from God. The protagonist of the Into the Unknown is haunted by an unknown voice calling her, Elsa, into the unknown space. That's why it draws her outside, into nature. The first verse makes clear the voice is from a ute who seems to be pursuing the protagonist, Elsa. As the song builds, we discover that you has a voice but is not seen. And it's a voice that wields a certain kind of growing power.
Mm-hmm.
And you might consider this you, hold on. And you might consider this you of sorts a kind of unknown divine being or anybody? The Force. Throughout the song, there is a repeated, is that choral? Mocking and questioning the protagonist's curiosity and contemplation, heavy thought. It is the voice of cynicism and doubt, the background noise questioning the questioning. The wrestling ultimately comes to a resolution in a series of questions that leads the protagonist to yield and follow this you. She succumbs. Are you out there? Do you know me? Can you feel me? Can you show me? Where are you going? Don't leave me alone. How do I follow you into the unknown? Oh my. Yeah, there is a fake god of this world coming, but let's back up for a second before he gets to this. He's already, the article writer, Pastor Joey, concluded that this you is a comparable to a form from an unknown God that can be fulfilled in Jesus. Just slap Jesus' name on that sucker. You need a Mother Earth? God, slap Jesus' name on it. By taking note in love of the artworks of the pagan culture, Paul could identify their unknown God as the one who would become known in the person of Jesus, the Messiah. So he concludes that by saying that, our children will follow. Oh, not my children. By saying that our children will follow this unknown you into a nuke. No, you demonic, horrible human being. Not my kids. Into a new kind of life where the longings of the stories they watched and read and listened to as children will become realized. That nostalgia, that comfort that you have as a child, that joy of watching cartoons, this is such a major entry point for unbelievable manipulation. They will not be able to resist this voice. This calling will be effective as they meet him and rejoice, knowing it's worth giving up comfort to heed his call, and then ask us to pray towards that end. You are so evil. Except what he failed to mention is that the you in the theme song, sung by Aurora, you know, who's covered in blood. they want the gnosis. Okay, and then he kind of pulls it all together. So, except what he failed to mention is that the UN theme song isn't a call from the true God or a call from Jesus or even a call to the true God revealed by general revelation, which Romans talks about. The movie and the entire Frozen series all actually already reveals this you to be Elsa's own heart. Oh, okay. And the entire theme of the movie teaches that we should not follow God, but we should follow our own hearts. Well, that's been put in movies and everything for as long as I can remember. You have, you know, Jennifer Lopez saying that she always follows her heart. Well, Jeremiah says that is a horrible idea because we are evil and wicked. So Mother Earth bringing forth this, you know, group of children that are in rebellion to God, that paganistically worship the earth, and AI Mother Earth to come, getting yoked up with her, being one, getting these, you know, whatever this forthcoming mark is in your hand or your forehead for those who will be here at that point after a very heavy thinning of the herd takes place. These are the things that are being purposefully put into people's minds and hearts and seeded into them, and they are priming the pump. And of course, God's word would tell you to get your sins forgiven on the cross through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ to become sons of God and manifest sons of God at that. Romans 8, my husband and I were just reading that. And we will be people of patience waiting for the Lord to move, because when he gives us glorified bodies, there will not be a bad consequence. Whereas if you take this mark and they try to upgrade your body into this humanity 2.0, this new creation in Christ, this paganistic, you worship all paths, all gods, all things, there is a massive judgment coming. And there is a warning that if you take that, it is a firm, hard rejection of Jesus Christ. And that is the one thing he didn't pay for on the cross. He paid for every other sin that you could ever possibly fathom or think of, but he did not pay for a rejection of that cross. See, doesn't that make sense? Why? Well, it's a blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. People have a million different ways as to how they go about securing and digging their heels in unbelief, rebellion, insubordination, and a refusal to obey Christ's gospel through faith, and he absolutely will not pay for those things. And that's all wrapped up into that unpardonable sin. There are people out there that try to teach that when the Pharisees were being rude to Jesus and said that he was doing these various miracles, which of course Moses said, you will have a prophet from among us that will come to you. I forget exactly how it's phrased, but be watching for that prophet. And then Hebrews 2 fills in all this great, 1 and 2 really fills in all this great detail work as to who that person is. You read through the scriptures and you're getting little bits and pieces of the puzzle pointing to the Christ, right? The sinless one, the one that would perform miracles and they would heal people. I mean, even his cousin, John the Baptist, who got thrown in the pokey, was like, did we get it right? He's the one, right? Can you go ask him? And Jesus quoted scripture back that I think it was Isaiah, if I'm not mistaken. But, you know, what do you see happening? What is the fruit of what's going on? The poor are getting the gospel. There's healings and so on and so forth. He says it so much more beautiful and poetic than I do. But he's like, yes, John, I'm the one. Because John's kind of scratching his head going, you're the one of Israel. At that point, they're all waiting for the kingdom to come, right? But God's like, what you don't get is Isaiah 53 has to happen first. The Son of Man must suffer all of these things and be, you know, killed and raised on the third day into an eternal new body. And he's making an eternal new mankind. But see, they didn't understand that. That's why we go by the feast, Passover, unleavened bread, first fruits. That's the gospel, death, burial, resurrection. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. We're wrapping up here. And then 50 days later, Pentecost, and you have the upper room being filled and baptized, all of these temples being lit up and filled with the Holy Spirit and these individual cloves of tongues of fire, whatever that is, go in power, speak my gospel. And all these little empty temples suddenly were filled with light. Now, it's not light that you can see, I'm convinced, but in that moment in Acts, you were able to see what the prophet was explaining. And so we are the city of this light. We are this city that is on a hill, this city that we are not to put a basket over a lamp, but to shine it out. There is a God that we worship who is the light. Now, there's a faker too, the light bearer. And we are not to confuse those two. This is a game of confusion. Now, I will probably end up doing another video because I have so much more to share with you about this and your brain machine, your coming brain implant. You're going to get a wireless brain. It's going to be good fun. No. And we should advise people not to take these upgrades, not to attempt to try to become like God. It didn't work well the first time. It will not work well the second attempt. So how do we know that this amalgamation from hell of putting all the world's religions that worship the false god of this world, so G-O-D with a small g, because remember, everything is about counterfeiting and copying what God has already done. They bring them together in one union, and they're going to call it the body of Christ, right? Because that's the major tenet that we have been discussing in video after video, even if other topics are floating around it. Why do we think that? Well, this guy gets it. Shockingly, this guy gets it. I don't think he knows about the Nar Israel piece of it and the Israel pushing their Messiah and that end of it. So you should add that into it. But listen, for just a
generic, unspecified God that is not bound by any doctrinal system. What?
That part I disagree with because I don't think he understands what the Jews, the Sanhedrin, the law emanating from a dictator, Messiah, who is a Jew. I don't think he understands that part of it. But they will be aligned together in the name of God. And I would put a small g on that, not a large.
Whatsoever. That's your one world religion. That's what's going to happen. And it's happening even now. It's happening.
Now, most people, when they watch a video like this, they would think, you know, there's no way that Christian people would ever yoke up with Hinduism or Buddhism or anything like that. There's no way that it would ever go that far. I mean, we understand that. Well, there's two things I want you to consider. Number one, the rapture will have taken place when this all comes to pass. So all your people who have the Holy Spirit living inside of them are already going to be gone. But number two, I want you to realize, this concept is not new. I'm not inventing this. I'm actually just relaying to you what's already being said in the world now. And unfortunately, the man who was the biggest name that was promoting the concept that I just shared with you on the whiteboard was Billy Graham. Billy Graham believed that there were people in other religions who were looking at the same God we were and were saved. They were just living in the light that they had at the time. And he believes they're going to heaven without the Bible or without even knowing the name of Jesus. That's what he taught and promoted. Let me just go straight to the horse's mouth.
And remember, mysticism, experiences in the supernatural, that is the glue that binds it together. And there is that commonality of that spiritual playing around with demonic entities, unclean spirits and familiar spirits who are jerks. They are within all of these different religions and mysticism and the apostate evil gnar slash Catholic slash, you know, whatever that would say Jesus is going to bring heaven to earth. Remember, their MO, and we've talked about this, Lance Wallnew and Robert Henderson, two very vocal, clear teachers that the whole world religion system is going to be yoked into the kingdom of God. But remember, that's going to be through the lens of the hidden hand that I don't think Spencer understands. Through the Sanhedrin's Mashiach. And all world religions will think that's their final, you know, incarnation of their God, Buddha, Krishna, whatever. Even Mother Earth is going to come as this AI entity, robot, God thing. They're going to give the spirit of Earth a voice or something where she is a God that rules, right? And then the Antichrist. But this is all being positioned, pushed. Remember, we talked about this, the Lori Mendoza's, the, I forget her name, a very Christian, prominent, governmental woman in Congress. She's not there anymore. I forget her name. Michelle Bachmann. Thank you, Lord. Michelle Bachmann and a whole group of people are pushing. The president is pushing. Remember, he's NAR. They're all pushing for The Hague to be moved to Israel for these prayer breakfasts. And remember, they're telling you, you must go to Israel to get your salvation. The kingdom of God, the Christians, the Jews and the Muslims, the Abrahamic faiths, all of that together. Then we lasso in all the other world religions. We sneak them deceptively into the kingdom of God. Lance Wallnew says, God told him so. We're totally going to use deceit. This is so evil. And this is what Billy Graham knew of it in his day before he died, the big giant liar that he was. Listen to what he says. So the premise has been that they're going to fake everything. They're going to fake a kingdom. They're going to fake a Messiah. They are an Israeli Messiah. They are going to fake a global, they're going to fake a government that is like the Messiah, who will have a kingdom of kings and priests, right? Well, so will they. They're called the false apostles. They have a false gospel. They have a false missionary effort where they just turn everybody into possessed fools in NAR. They have a fake father, mother, God coming, Satan, the AI, the abomination of desolation. They have a fake Holy Spirit. They have all of this. And see, they're going to wrap it all into this big giant lie that this is the body of Christ. This is the anti-bride. Listen to what Billy says, and then we'll stop.
Let you see what he said himself.
Tell me, what do you think is the future of Christianity? Well, Christianity and being a true believer, you know, I think there's the body of Christ, which comes from all the Christian groups around the world.
Listen very carefully to what this hound dog Mason says. He's just identified the body of Christ as being made up of all the world religions, and he says Christians, that they're even going to steal our name and say we're Christians. This, we've talked about this. This is why Hollywood, they're all popping up going, I'm a Christian. I'm a Christian. I'm a Christian. Kanye's a Christian. We're all Christians. They're stealing your identity. And you're watching it happen now. And after the church leaves, bye-bye, they're going to get worse. And then they're going to start receiving the corrections of God, the 21 judgments. Those will not be fun. But that's what happens when you usurp God. You usurp and replace the Son of God with this AI enhancement. Remember, the brain chip machine, they've probably been making this thing for a long time, the savior of the world, who's not going to be a savior. He's going to be a nightmare. And they want to usurp the heirs of God, the heirs of Christ, the bride. And that's the Babylon that you see. It's all together. And look, it's going to be called the body of Christ.
That there were people in other religions who were looking at the same God we were and were saved. They were just living in the light that they had at the time. And he believes they're going to heaven without the Bible or without even knowing the name of Jesus. That's what he taught and promoted. Let me just go straight to the horse's mouth, let you see what he said himself.
Tell me, what do you think is the future of Christianity? Well, Christianity and being a true believer. You know, I think there's the body of Christ, which comes from all the Christian groups around the world, or outside the Christian groups.
He said it comes from all the Christian groups in the world. Okay, so that's all your denominationalism. That's basically ecumenicism. But then he says even outside of Christian groups. What he's saying there, there are people that are in these tribes overseas that they don't have a Bible, or they just understand there's a God, and they believe in that God. He believes that they're saved. That's exactly what I'm saying. That is the merging of Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam, and the occult with Christianity. That's the one world religion. This man's promoting that by his own words.
I think everybody that loves Christ or knows Christ, whether they're conscious of it or not, they're members of the body of Christ.
No.
What? Loves Christ or knows Christ, whether they're conscious of it or not, are members of the body of Christ? That is the one world religion. I'm not the only guy saying this is what's going to happen. It's already being said.
And I don't think that we're going to see a great sweeping revival that will turn the whole world to Christ at any time. I think James answered that, the Apostle James, in the first council in Jerusalem, when he said that God's purpose for this age is to call out a people for his name. And that's what God is doing today. He's calling people out of the world for his name, whether they come from the Muslim world or the Buddhist world or the Christian world or the non-believing world. They are members of the body of Christ because...
What? He's saying there's people in the occult, the unbelieving world, that are members of the body of Christ because...
They're called by God.
So being called by God, as you are seeing this Mother Earth-esque communicative, you know, communicating through Elsa or to Elsa about this union... To listen to your own heart, to be called into something greater than herself. Billy Graham labeling the world religions that are unbelievers and unbelievers, not born again, and therefore not qualified through grace because of rejection. What's the unpardonable sin? Saying no and digging your heels in. Sustained unbelief. Sustained insubordination. Hello. And calling that abomination the body of Christ. Homeboy knew back then what they were doing. We're trying to show you where this stuff is headed.
They may not even know the name of Jesus, but they know in their heart that they need something that they don't have, and they turn to the only light that they have, and I think that they are saved and that they're going to be with us in heaven.
That is universalism.
Yeah.
This is the worst thing Billy Graham ever said in his life.
Yeah.
These are words that will haunt him for eternity.
Yes.
But that's what I'm saying. This is the direction that everything's going. And the Wiccas and the Christians and the Hindus and the Buddhists and everybody's going to merge together. And they're looking for one man to teach them how to do this and to show them the way. And he's coming.
See, that's why in Billy's mind, they don't have to know Christ. Because... he knows as a Mason, this is their crap. This is their witchcraft. They're going to bring forth their own man-made savior, the AI Mashiach. And I'm not exactly sure what other kind of stuff, mystical, alien, I don't know. I mean, they've been working on that angle for longer than I've been alive, actually. I don't know. But they're going to craft their own savior. And the Jews tell us when the Messiah comes, he'll tell us everything. So that's why people didn't previously need to know about Christ. They're all going to be locked up in this universal salvation. It all makes sense now. You know, as we have been walking along, pointing out heresy, we as Christians, with different blogs and videos and all of this stuff, blah, 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 all of this stuff, on and on and on it goes, going heresy, 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 bad, bad, evil, bad. Here's where scripture teaches you. But this is interesting. Now you're seeing the other end of it, right? That was the front end. Now you're seeing the back end. Now you're seeing the goal. Why? You're hearing the why. The why have they been pushing universalism? For those who are on their phones and cannot read this font, what I said here was perfect example. The Shack movie and book equal universalism. Who promoted that? Christians. And the soundtrack, Christians, King and Country. I don't remember who they all were. Lauren Daigle, Need to Breathe. I don't remember who else. They're fine with the idea of heaven come to earth. And they're fine with the idea that we'll just, when the Messiah comes, he'll teach us everything. I mean, I don't plan on being here for this nightmare, but for those who will be. And they all get sucked in and blessed in this tikkun olam. And by the way, they have another Jerusalem council. And in that same Lori Cordoza and Jan Markell, and I mean, there's lots of people. Mark Biltz, Rabbi Shapir. There's so many voices. They're all kind of Josh Peck, even I've heard him. There's everybody at Skywatch. There's this constant prevalent pushing that you have to support Israel no matter what. This is to get everybody on board for their Tikkun Olam and their towards Jerusalem Council too. And we've done videos on that.
What I hear you saying that it's possible for Jesus Christ to come into a human heart and soul and life, even if they've been born in darkness and have never had an exposure to the Bible. Is that a correct interpretation of what you're saying?
Yes, it is, because I believe that. I've met people in various parts of the world in tribal situations that they had never seen a Bible or heard about a Bible and never heard of Jesus, but they believed in their heart that there was a God, and that they tried to live a life that was quite apart from the surrounding community in which they...
find that hard to believe, but let's just say that he is telling the truth. I find it a little strange, but that's okay. He's teaching a Roman Catholic-esque, really any world religion outside of Jesus, that Britney Spears made a song, you know, you better work, B, a works-oriented salvation, a universal, which is so ridiculous. Works-based salvation. That almost seems incongruent with one another, but this is the insanity and chaos that is the fruit born from Lucifer the Light, the false god of this world. He doesn't have to be consistent. Jesus does.
It's fantastic. I'm so thrilled to hear you say that. There's a wideness in God's mercy. There is.
No, there's not. I leave you with this. Jesus said, let's just go to the scripture. Narrow is the way. It's what, Matthew? Yeah, Matthew 7:14. Why did God make salvation such a narrow path? Do you know why he did? Because amidst all the lies and false gods, he wanted to make it simple. He wanted to make it clear. He wanted to make it so abundantly obvious who the Holy One of Israel was, and that he would come in love and compassion, that when they drew blood on him, he actually said and meant it, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. That's preposterous. That is not how the human nature works. But see, he wasn't tainted with evil. He was good. Enter through the narrow gate. For wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction. That destruction is eternal destruction. The loss of God is what that is. In hell, with your wormy worm blanket, because you unbelievers who refuse to come to him, although you're invited, you better hurry. You better hurry up. You're running out of time. But for those who say no, 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 and no, and then God accepts your rejection, you are the garbage that gets thrown into the lake of fire. You didn't want mercy or grace or goodness or power or strength or love or hope or generosity or truth. And so that's the booby prize. That he's giving you what you wanted. My word, what more do you want from him? He just gives you what you asked for. You might say, well, I didn't ask for that. Well, what did you ask for? You didn't ask for love incarnate and all that that stands for. What'd you think you were going to get? The lie? And the lie was going to turn out to be a good thing? That doesn't make sense. This is the lunacy the earth is running towards. And many enter through it, that broad road, that wide grace, Schuller and Billy Graham said. But small is the gate, narrow is the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. That's freaky. That should freak you out. That has always freaked me out. Matthew 7, 13 and 14. Crystal clear. Thank you so much if you stuck with me through the whole video. I know it was kind of long, but I hope that you got a lot of good information. And you have pastors leading you to the goddess, leading you to the mark of the beast, whatever that forthcoming thing is, leading you to believe that you can attain godhood through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. That you can yoke with goddess and everything's going to be okay, bubby. And it is most certainly not. And something like that wants to get inside your brain. Join me for the next video when we will go further in depth into this very topic. Thank you so much and God bless you.